are Locked On MLB. Your daily MLB podcast. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network. Your team every day.
Hey, we're here with Jeff Carr, host of Locked On Reds. And if you're only casually following baseball right now, you may not realize the Cincinnati Reds, as of this recording, are a playoff team. They would be playing the defending World Series champion Los Angeles Dodgers in a wild card game. Now, let me just bring this up, okay? I don't want to jinx anything here because, look, the Reds are in position for the second wild card spot. All it takes is for the Padres to snap to it and the Reds to go on a moderate losing streak to turn this into a true nail-biting September for the Reds. They don't have an insurmountable lead. You know, and the Padres are a talented team. And even though they're getting some terrible years from supposedly reliable players, at this point, you're asking them, give us 1 month. Just give us one decent month. And any team can have a decent month, and any team can have a lousy month. And so it would behoove the Reds to not lose games like they did on Sunday to the Miami Marlins. You know, you know, those are the type of games, especially against teams like the Marlins. I made this point on the podcast, but people automatically say, well, that's a win, that's a win, that's a win. And just as the Phillies were trying to dust themselves off and get back to the NL East race, as they've stumbled and bumbled with teams like the Arizona Diamondbacks. Now, these teams circle the schedule saying, oh, you think you're just going to get through us? Well, guess what? You're going to have to get through us. And, you know, these aren't always easy games to predict.
And to be honest with you, the Phillies have that same thing as the Reds do, because if you ask our good friend Millard over at Locked On Diamondbacks, he's got bragging rights over me because the Reds went 1-5 against Arizona this year. So there's some things that we can point to at the end of the year if they don't make it. If the Padres do make that run, there's been plenty of things like Sunday where we can say that's the point where the Reds really need to flip the script a little bit. Because the guy that they faced on Sunday, all credit to him, he was a great prospect in the Oakland A's organization, having a little bit of a rough year, came into the game with a 7.9 ERA in Jesus Luzardo, and he pitched shutout baseball. Talking about
he was a top prospect, and sometimes top prospects find the reason why they were top prospects. You know, sometimes, you know, yes, he had a very disappointing, I was in the Bay Area when he was brought up as this supposed next ace of the team. And in the end, he was expendable to bring in Marte, and Marte has been a wonderful addition to the Oakland A's. Right. But yeah, sometimes a pitcher like that is going to reach back and say, oh yeah, this is why I was a highly touted prospect.
He just finds that button and hits that extra gear. And that's what happened on Sunday, because the Reds couldn't do anything against him. That was a quick game, too. In 2021 parlance, it was less than 3 hours. So I think that you just got to kind of bounce back from this with the upcoming schedule, because like you mentioned, the Padres are a talented team. To expect the Reds to continue to lose and yet still keep that playoff spot is folly. Because they're going to do that pretty quick. They're going to lose that playoff spot pretty quick. And a lot of it just has to do with how are they going to employ certain players. I talked about Eugenio Suarez earlier. He's a guy that they keep running out there. They just picked up Asdrubal Cabrera from those Diamondbacks, which was a huge get. Like, I love, for a personal standpoint, what the Diamondbacks did for him, putting him into a playoff race. But I also love the fact that the Diamondbacks sort of put him out there and the Reds were able to grab him, because I've always liked Asdrubal Cabrera. I thought he's been a versatile person on the infield. He can play a lot of different positions. Plus, he has exactly what the Reds are needing. This year, I think he's hitting 290 against left-handed pitching, and he's got an OPS over 800. And the team, I think, is hitting below 220. I haven't looked at that. I'm going to look at that for tomorrow's podcast, but it's absolutely phenomenal. You just throw a left-handed pitcher against this Reds team, which four out of their next five games are against left-handed starting pitchers, and you really confound a lineup that for the most part has been one of the best teams in baseball at scoring runs.
Well, and one of the other things just to mention is that using both FanGraph and Baseball Reference WAR, Asdrubal Cabrera has the highest WAR total of anybody named Asdrubal.
Yes.
So I think you can't beat that.
You
can't beat that. And that's what you're looking for. Well, there's a couple of things, because I'm going to do two things here. I'm going to stay focused on the now and then get way ahead of myself. Okay. Focusing on the now, the Reds currently have the visitor spot in the wild card game, and the Padres haven't played yet. As of this recording, the Reds have a game and a half lead. If the Padres win, it's going to be shortened to a game. If the Padres lose, it'll widen to two games. But Cincinnati is only, as of this recording, 3.5 games ahead of the St. Louis Cardinals. And they're about to go into a three-game series with the Cardinals. And then in about a week after that, they're going to be going to St. Louis for another series. Now, the Cardinals have been laying in the weeds as an underachieving team for almost this entire season. Now, we saw the Braves being exactly that team as well, and they snapped, and suddenly they're going to run away with the division. The Cardinals have a ton of talent on the team. It hasn't clicked so far this season. However, the number of games they have to make up is doable, especially with six head-to-head games with Cincinnati. And as I mentioned before, you're only asking them for one really good month. So yep. This is a huge series coming up starting on Monday against the St. Louis Cardinals.
It absolutely is, because if you're looking at the health of the Padres and the Cardinals right now, the Cardinals almost look as threatening. Like, I know that the talent wise, the Padres have the better team, but the Cardinals have a shot because the Reds aren't playing the Padres anymore. Thankfully, the Padres own them in the season series as well. But I look at this Cardinals lineup that includes two really awesome hitters there in the middle, and Goldschmidt and Arenado. How do the Reds pitch around them? Plus, you've got the emergence of Tyler O'Neill, who has been absolutely phenomenal this season. And the Reds really got to pick it up when you're looking at some of the matchups that are coming up past that, because yes, they are winnable series, but if you don't win these series against the Cardinals, you're putting yourself way behind the eight ball. When it comes to this race, I think it's very important. I know that you had mentioned too, that you kind of picked them to win the division. I had picked the Brewers beforehand, but I thought the Cardinals would be there right there with the Reds for second. Yeah. I didn't think the Brewers are going to be this good, though. That's for
me
sure.
Neither.
I thought it was going to be a tight race.
I thought the Brewers were going to be a wild card contender. Yeah. I did not think their starting pitching would be as good as it's been, and as deep as it's been. I mean, like they're four or five deep in their starting staff, and of course, after making, they made the deal to strengthen their infield in the deal with Tampa Bay, and all of a sudden that's one of those deals where it's not in a vacuum. How did it affect the rest of the team? I think really helped Milwaukee. By the way, send a thank you note to the Pittsburgh Pirates for scoring three runs in the bottom of the ninth to defeat the Cardinals on Sunday, because it would be a little bit tighter but that's a prime example. The Pirates are a terrible team. The Pirates are a terrible team, and the Cardinals are a surging team. And I'm sure the Pirates are like, you're not just going to run over us. Yeah, we're going to show a little bit of pride.
Yeah, I mean, this is the time of year where the teams that people deem having nothing to lose are super dangerous. I mean, the Reds saw that a couple series ago when they faced the Cubs at home. The Cubs took two out of three, and the two games that they won were not close. They were not games that the Reds looked like they should have won. They looked like they were completely outclassed. So it wasn't like bad luck here, bad luck there. No, the Cubs were just better. And that's a team that's not even playing for anything right now. So what do teams like the Reds and the Cardinals and the Padres, and the Padres got a really tough schedule coming up, so I don't know that they're going to have to worry about this too much. I think they play Arizona for the next three, but other than that, it's everybody who's on top of everything. But I think that playoff teams who just show up and think, well, that's all we had to do tonight, let's pop a cork on tonight's game, they're going to be really surprised. And that's what the Pirates did. I mean, the Pirates scored eight runs in the seventh inning. Was it two nights ago against the Cardinals? That was insane too.
Well, I want to just rewind the tape back about a little less than a month and a half ago. On July 19th, the Reds lost that absolutely bizarre 15 to 11 extra inning weirdness to the Mets. And the Mets at the time were in first place by themselves. That seems like a long time. It was late July. It's now late August. Now the world has turned since then. And that loss put the Reds to just two games above 500 heading into the stretch where people were thinking about making trades. So this would have been the 19th of July. So we're entering late July, barely above 500. And a real fringe wild card because the Padres were still the fourth best team in the National League. They were better than the Mets. They were barely behind Milwaukee, and they looked like they were a good run away from making a charge for the West title, because obviously the other shoe is going to fall and San Francisco is going to go on a big losing streak. There's no way they could keep this up. Little did we know. From that moment where the Reds were just two games above 500, wondering what the heck they're going to do, they've gone 23-14. Now, the Dodgers and the Giants and the Braves have all been ungodly in terms of their winning streak during that stretch of time, but the Reds have only been three games behind their pace. In other words, the Reds' pace that they've gone on since that absolute gut punch loss to the Mets has been, they've been an elite team for about a month and a half now.
Right.
And what I find really intriguing, and this is where I'm getting ahead of myself, is if you put the Reds in a one-game playoff with Los Angeles, and as it stands right now, it does not look like the Giants are going to falter anytime soon. Like the Dodgers won like what, 20 out of 25 games and gained half a game in the standings. You know, because the Giants kept matching them every single game. Right. And so that would means the way the playoffs are set up now, I would get rid of divisions if I were in charge of things, but they're not. They don't ask me. But that would mean the Reds would be in a one-game playoff with LA. And I don't think the Reds are better than LA. I don't think the Reds could beat LA in a best-of-seven series, but they can beat them in a one-game series, especially if they have Wade Miley on the mound and if Bell basically says, do you know what, all pitchers on deck, all hands on deck, and say, you know what, we'll have Maley, we'll have Gutierrez, we'll have Sonny Gray. You know, you have one you earmark to start game one of the division series. Like maybe you say, all right, Luis Castillo is going to start game one of the division series. Every other pitcher is available. And you hand the ball to Miley, and if he gives you nine, great. But if you don't rely on your bullpen, you use your rotation to get through that game. Because for this Reds team, getting to the division series, I think, would be such a huge accomplishment. And then if they play San Francisco, obviously San Francisco is a great team this year, but they don't have this aura of this unbeatable defending champion.
Right.
You know, a team that has nothing to lose is dangerous. But in that one game against LA, that was what I was thinking. Forget the bullpen. I just literally say, Luis Castillo, you're starting game one of the division series against San Francisco. Everyone else, get ready to give me two or three innings. Wade,
you're speaking my language, man.
Wade, give me nine. make this a moot point.
You are scratching me right where I itch. I've been saying this for a couple of days now. It's like, if you really look at it, and if the Reds make it, if you stack up the Reds and Dodgers pitching staffs together in a conventional way, the Dodgers absolutely have the advantage. But if you think outside the box, which this has really taken over Reds country here recently as far as thinking goes, hopefully it's at least in David Bell's mind, a little bee in his bonnet type situation here. Go with a couple of starters, piggyback them. If it's Wade Miley, and then you can bring in a fireballer, or if you start with a fireball and then you bring in Wade Miley, whatever it is, you can really do a nice 1-2 punch with Wade Miley and somebody else, because Miley and Castillo, they all have really high velocity, high movement pitches that kind of go the opposite way of Wade Miley. So I would love to see that happen, because I agree with you. If you're talking about a puncher's chance, a one shot, let's see what you got. I think the Reds actually have a shot to beat the Dodgers. And I agree with you. The seventh game series doesn't excite me very much against a team like LA because they've got a much deeper roster. But that one game could really be interesting. And this season will absolutely be a success if they make that DS, because they went through the weird three-game wild card thing and they only played two and they didn't score a run like we mentioned earlier. I'm not mad about it. I'm not, you know, I'm not bitter at all.
Yeah. Well, and I'll just say, there is a team that did exactly what you and I are just saying. Now, it wasn't about a one-game playoff. Although, when the Nationals won the wild card game against the Milwaukee Brewers a few years ago, they used both Strasburg and Scherzer in that wild card game because they knew what was on the line there. But the year before that, yes, I know, Astros fans, I know that the Red Sox were doing shenanigans as well when they won the World Series in 2018. That being said, Cora used Sale out of the rotation and bullpen, Porcello out of the rotation and bullpen, Price out of the rotation and bullpen, Yavaldi out of the rotation and bullpen, Rodriguez out of the rotation and bullpen. There were key moments throughout the postseason that he brought in Chris Sale to relieve, David Price with the game on the line to relieve. Nathan Eovaldi had the best start and the best relief appearance of that postseason. And Porcello became a revelation out of the bullpen and was a huge reason why the Red Sox, whose middle relievers that year were sometimes shaky, was basically saying, forget it, we'll use Porcello. What do we care? Eventually, they used Chris Sale to pitch the final inning to clinch the World Series. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And I hope that Bell, who sees that he has the strength in the rotation to be able to mix, match, and do that, would be able to do that. And, you know, the Reds will have no pressure on them in a wild card game, and the Dodgers will have all the pressure in the world. Because if they win, 98 to 100 games and have to play a do or die against Wade Miley, can you imagine how they'd be pressing? I think you can. I think you
can. And when you're pressing against an 87 mile an hour cutter, you're probably not going to hit too many of them.
That's right. Well, you hit them all, Jeff Carr. And tell people where they can follow your terrific podcast.
You can follow the podcast wherever you get your podcast, Sully. We're also on YouTube as well, so you can see my smiling face, my confused face, my concerned face, whatever face I'm making, especially after the Reds win. It's a lot of face, or after the Reds lose, it's a lot of faces. So that's going to happen tomorrow. But you can follow it on YouTube as well. And you can follow me on Twitter at Jeff Carr with three F's. And you can follow the show at Locked On Reds.
3F Jeff. That's what we're calling you. 3F Jeff. And you can follow us on Locked On MLB Pods. You can follow me. I'm your pal Sully. I'm at Sully Baseball on Twitter, Sully Baseball Podcast on Instagram. Talking about the 2021 World Series champion Cincinnati Reds and their back-to-back Cy Young Award winners. Can you believe it? All right. Well, at least the team that is putting together, let's face it, a really fun run to the postseason. With the Vados and the Winkers and all of them in the world who are just hitting the ball, pitching the ball. They're a lot of fun to watch. If you're a casual baseball fan, catch the Cincinnati Reds and maybe have a chance to catch them in the postseason. This has been Locked On MLB for the 30th day of August, 2021. I'm your host, Paul Francis Sullivan. Please call me Sully.